So it's a great pleasure to have a chance to talk to Francis Wood. Francis, when and where were you born?
I was born in London in 1948, in sort of East London, Clapton.
Mm-hmm. Tell me something. Some people like to go back to the Norman Conquest, but you don't have to go that far back. Tell me something about your ancestry, your grandparents or whatever.
Yes, we're not very brilliant in my family. Well, we've got one person who's very brilliant on ancestry, but my mother's family seemed to have come from the sort of Welsh border areas, and they had shoe shops, and they were Quakers and things, I think. Quite important people in places like Leinster and so on. Anyway, that's one side of the family. My father's family, you've got Quakers and then Methodists, so they're very kind of plain religion. And my father's family were Catholic. His mother was Irish. She was Orion. She was known as Limerick Jim as a child because she was a tomboy. but there was a sort of nice complication in that family in that they were mixed in with Bernals, who were Sephardic Jews who had come over to Ireland and converted. So, well, I think what one of the sort of Bernal family fathers did was say, you'll be Catholic, you'll be Jewish, you'll be Catholic, you'll be Jewish. And so we have a bit of Sephardic Jewish through. So my father's side's quite complicated, but basically Catholic. And that's one of the things I remember from childhood, having one grandmother and grandfather who were very, very kind of plain and Methodist-y. And then the other one was a Catholic. So we used to go to church if they were staying, to very different churches. And it was all slightly confusing. The differences were a bit baffling to us.
Do you think that made you gave you an interest in intercultural exchanges?
I think it made me an observer of intercultural exchanges. Yes, I remember my Methodist grandmother flouncing out of a church because we'd had to go to one. I think their usual minister was away and they'd had to go somewhere else, and incense was produced, and so we were out of that church in about 30 seconds, which, you know, was very interesting. But I can't say it sort of drew me into religion, but it did leave me fascinated by the difficulties it produces.
Mm. Tell me something about your grandparents. Did you know them at all, or did they influence you?
My father's father died when my father was quite young, I think when he was about 10 or 11. He was a solicitor in County Durham, but he got, I think he went for some simple operation, this is all pre-National Health, and got tetanus as a result and died very young, leaving his widow with three young children. And so my father's life, I think it was quite difficult as a child. So we knew Granny. She was Granny Wood. I liked her very much. She was a very sort of gentle character, very good looking. But we had more really to do with my mother's parents, partly because Granny Wood lived further up in Durham. And of course, you know, you think now, of course, transport's so easy. But then I remember going up with my dad on the Pullman train, which was very exciting, once when I was about 10, to visit Granny Wood and various elderly great aunts and so on. It was terribly exciting. You know, we didn't travel that much up to Durham, but my mother's parents lived in Reading, so we saw them quite often. And I wouldn't say they were much of an influence. They were, you know, they were very good people, but they were kind of quite boring. My father, who was a very sort of intellectual sort of character, I always remember they often would come at Christmas and we used to pray that it wouldn't snow because they might not get away. My father would be anxiously pacing up and down looking at the sky, making sure that they would get away because, you know, only a little was enough for him.
And coming down to your parents, what did they do and how did they influence you?
Well, I think there's huge influence there. My father, I suppose, was a man of huge, I don't know if you say intelligent, he was very, very intelligent, he was very good with people, but he was he was just fascinated by everything, very widely interested and very witty. He went to Oxford eventually. I mean, he had to get scholarships through school and so on, went to Oxford and studied French and was thinking, I think, of doing research into medieval French, into some particular Anglo-Norman Bible or something, but he didn't in the end do that. But he went into the British Museum as a French specialist. So that was before the war. at a time when they still lit coal fires in the offices in the morning, and some people wore wing collars to work and so on. And he worked all his life in the British Museum library, as I say, French specialist, particularly sort of early-ish French. But then because of family, you know, the need to support family, he had to sort of work his way up through the administrative levels. I remember it was all very exciting, him becoming an assistant keeper, then a deputy keeper, and then a principal keeper, and so on. And he ended up as head of the Department of Printed Books, which, and the nice thing for him, I think, though, because I think he was a very good administrator, because I was very touched when he died, and I was working in the British Library, which was the successor to the British Museum Library. There are all sorts of people who came up and said, oh, your father was so wonderful with people that he treated everyone exactly the same. He made no distinction between a cabinet minister and a cleaner, because he was very interested in people. Anyway, so he's sort of creeping up the hierarchy, if you like. But when he retired, I think he was quite depressed when he retired for about a year, but about 2 years after he retired, he went back to the, well, it was then the British Library, to work on a big cataloguing project called the 18th Century Short Title Catalogue, because he knew where all the little caches of 18th century pamphlets and unexpected groups of 18th century books had got muddled in. The British Museum Library was a bit of a kind of oddment as far as kind of organisation was concerned. You'd have reorganisations and things would get moved about and some things would get forgotten. And as he'd worked there so long, he knew where everything was. And so he worked with a team of young people and he absolutely adored it. He was fantastically happy. And he worked a lot on, well, he loved the 18th century. He liked finding silly French descriptions of England, you know, with some horror about toast and a description of marmalade, which was just considered. And so he enjoyed himself enormously because then he was doing, you know, what he enjoyed most, which was sort of scholarly work with books. My mother was not quite the first generation of her family to go to university. Her father had started medical training, but then that was interrupted by the First World War, and he became a pilot in the Flying Corps and eventually a prisoner of war because they came down in what they thought was France, but it turned out to be Germany. He spent the rest of the war in a grand castle being a prisoner. But when he came back, his wife had already had their first child and he felt he couldn't carry on with studying. So anyway, my mother did French as well at university, and my parents met in a complicated way after the war, but because of the war, because both of them had been in Bletchley. My father was seconded from most of the people who knew languages from the British Museum were seconded to Bletchley to work on decoding, you know, the non-computer side of it. And my mother was in the Wrens, and she was posted there, and where she acted as secretary to Angus Wilson, who had been, well, he was part of the British Museum Library at the time, and therefore a great friend of my father. And after the war, he introduced them at one of his many parties. So they met sort of this roundabout way. They hadn't actually met at Bletchley, but they had both been there.
And what was their character?
My father, he's a man with he had a smallish circle of friends, but they were very close friends, people, and he was very, very witty. I used to really enjoy, we had lovely family suppers, you know, every day. Dad would come home from work. He wouldn't speak to anyone until he'd gone upstairs and taken his tie off, because he hated a tie and a suit. And then we would sit down and have supper together, and he was terribly funny. I had one brother who's 2 years younger than me, and they were highly enjoyable times, just laughing a great deal. I mean, he had a huge wit. My mother, not as witty. I think she often felt slightly left out of conversations like that, but she's a fantastically energetic character. My father would be quite happy reading anywhere, reading all sorts of things, but my mother always wanted to be doing things, and even she's now 93 and she's kind of unstoppable at the moment. She's always got ideas of something that could be improved, something we could get them to do this, we should introduce so-and-so to so-and-so. And she's very small, very kind of wiry. I mean, she's not as energetic now, sadly, because her balance is not so good. But you know, if she was better balanced, she'd still be tearing around. As it is, she still gets around, but not at quite the same terrifying speed. So very sort of live wire kind of character.
Mm.
And she gave up any idea of doing things sort of when I was born, I think. She was a housewife and mother for only about 10 years, actually. Then she did a teacher training course and became a teacher, first in primary schools and then in secondary schools teaching French, which I think she quite enjoyed, and it was a good thing. I mean, she wasn't the sort of person who could be doing nothing all day. So she was a teacher for ages and ages.
Hmm. What's your first memory, apart from sort of trees waving above the pram memory?
But I don't really remember trees waving above. my first memory is a sort of... Well, I've got two, I think. I've got a kind of longish, probably mixed memory of sunshine in the back garden that I used to love to go. We lived in a little house in East Finchley, sort of in North London, which had a jolly nice but tiny garden. There was a swing at the bottom, and eventually we got a wonderful trapeze, which we hung there instead of a swing when we got a bit older. And of just being in the front garden, the back garden, it always felt like a sunny weekend, you know, a sunny Sunday morning, nobody else there, and me hanging upside down on the trapeze. I have sort of very strong memory of that. I have another memory which
I
think...
How old do you think you were then?
I was probably sort of from six onwards. That's not a terribly early memory.
Mm.
I have another memory which... I think it's interesting about sort of early memories that, you know, they get a bit muddled up with things. A memory of being in hospital... surrounded by bowls, and to me they're brightly coloured bowls, but they can't have been, because I think when I was two I apparently managed to climb out of my cot onto the top of a wardrobe where there were some aspirins, and I ate them, and so I was rushed to hospital and stomach pumped, and I think the bowls were there in the hope that I might be sick, but I sort of remember them as coloured, but they must have been white enamel with a blue stripe. But
So you were only two when this
yes,
memory...
Yes, yeah.
Interesting.
Well, I think that was probably what I'm remembering is the sort of the panic in others and me absolutely failing to understand what the panic was about.
What was your first school?
My first school... We first went to a sort of nursery school called Brookfields, I think. Well, I think my mother taught for a bit in Highgate. This was a kind of privately run... kindergarten, which I didn't much enjoy. I remember there they used to put the little half teeny weeny bottles of milk that we got, they used to put them in front of the gas fire and warm them up, and warm milk's absolutely horrible. And you could say I don't want mine warmed up, but one day there was one left and they said they insisted it must be mine, and I had to drink this warm milk. And I felt, you know, for years afterwards, the unfairness. It wasn't mine. I hadn't asked for it, and I hated it. And then I went to Highgate Primary after that, which was just not actually probably the nearest school. And it was because East Finchley to Highgate, we were in different boroughs, and we had to get a bus to get there from East Finchley up the road past Highgate Woods. But my parents chose it, especially because the headmistress was a progressive teacher who was a member of the Labour Party, and that was terribly important to them. She was a very nice woman, Mrs. Jobson, I think it was probably a very good school. I think she probably was quite enlightened for the 50s. And after the first year, well, I didn't like the infants. I think when I got into the juniors, it was fine. In the infants, I just always had that sense of wearing a blazer that was much too big for me, somehow being lost in the blazer. And also of the food.
Mm.
The food was ghastly, terrible.
This was about 1955, was it?
Yes, yeah. Mm. It may not have been to do with, you know, it being post-war. It was just, I just didn't like institutional food. And you had, there were evil dinner ladies who would just make you eat everything, and they would stand over you until you learnt to very quickly early on, cram all your food into your blazer pocket, another reason to hate your blazer, so that it looked as if you'd eaten it. I mean, otherwise you were just left there. No, everyone else had gone out to play, and just you faced with some terrible tubular liver or something in front of you. It was, oh, awful. My brother, who's younger than me, made a similar fuss about school lunches. And because he was always indulged, he was allowed to go back to Brookfield, the nursery school, for lunch, where the lunch was much more like home cooking. But I was not granted that privilege. I had to sit there. But as I say, I learned very quickly to get it all into my pockets before the dinner ladies noticed.
Around this time, sort of 6 to 10, did you have any particular hobbies or interests? Did you collect things or read things or...?
Oh, reading was always... I mean, books were my complete and utter passion. And I can remember even... Yes, it must have been before I was 11, engaging with one of the second-hand bookshops on the Archway Road in Highgate to sell books that I'd read, and so that I could buy more books. So I was sort of dealing in books, as it were, at an early age. so reading was fantastically important. I played a lot with dolls. I liked making clothes for them, particularly. I liked sewing. And my brother and I had very complicated games together. We were quite good friends. And we used to play games which involved building cities all over the sitting room floor, huge, great cities of sort of farmhouse-sized people and farmhouse animals and bits of the farm and bits of this. And then we would always put the piano stool upside down, and that was Battersea Power Station, which was part of our city. And my mother says we used to talk in horrible squeaky voices, you know, as our little people had their lives. So I didn't collect anything much else except, as I say, books, but it was to read them. I didn't want to collect them particularly as old, because I wanted to get on to the next one. So I read and read, and my parents were fantastic about reading. I think they were terribly good at steering me towards books at the right sort of age. I mean, I remember reading Father and Son and Lark Rise to Candleford. And
is it Father and Son?
That's Goss. Yes, which is...
It's quite an old book. I mean, it's for a...
Yes, but it's a good book for a sort of about 11-year-old, actually. Mm. Well, I don't know. At least I enjoyed it very much at that time. Partly this, you know, the mad father and things. I don't know. Period piece, too, I remember being steered towards, which is a lovely book, yeah.
Mm. Those are all sort of, I would have thought, late teenage books rather than...
Yes, but I was getting them at sort of 11, 12, I think.
What about the usual 11, 12 things, like Rudyard Kipling and Enid Blyton? And
we weren't allowed Enid Blyton. Mm. We weren't allowed comics, and we weren't allowed
Noel
Enid Blyton.
Stretfield and...
I read Noel Stretfield at great length, yes. Mm. All of those, every single one, whether it was ballet or horses or whatever. But my parents were convinced that Enid Blyton was bad for children.
Just William and...
Oh, yes, yes. Mm. Just, I still like Just William very, very much. And Anthony Buckeridge, I remember. Mm. I remember going to a children's exhibition at Olympia to meet him and get him to sign my book. And then, so I was quite keen on following things. And I remember two things, like listening to the radio, Children's Hour, and they talked about Ernest Shepherd's memoirs, Drawn from Memory, and sort of going out specially to buy that. And that was a huge success as well. I loved that, and still do, again.
Mm.
So I suppose quite a lot of biography, actually, quite a lot of factual stuff beyond Noel Stretfield.
Mm. Arthur Ransom? I suppose that's more for boys.
And I liked Arthur Ransom, except for the pictures. I mean, I thought the pictures were terrible and a disgrace and should not have been allowed. I remember my being ill once and having one of them read to me, and that was much more satisfying than having to read it and avoid the pictures yourself.
Mm. from Highgate, you went on to Highgate Senior School? Or?
No, I went to North London Collegiate School, because in those days, you know, you did the 11 plus, but I had been sent to go to, I went to City of London School for Girls and North London Collegiate to see about, and on both of those it had to be a sort of scholarship through the Girls Public Day School Trust or something. It was, you could get a full scholarship to go. I remember City of London was utterly dismal. The school was then on the banks of the Thames, but there was absolutely nowhere to play. At the middle of the day, you just went down into a basement surrounded by radiators and boilers, where there was one table tennis table, and you just lined up and got sort of one crack at a at a table tennis ball, which was, I thought, no fun at all. Whereas North London Collegiate was in this wonderful, great green grassy area surrounded by fields and so on. So I went there.
Where is that?
It's sort of between Edgware and Stanmore. Mm. It's in a very nice old house, Cannons, which it was the home of the Duke of Chandos, for whom Handel was music master. So part of it was this very beautiful old house with a new bit sort of stuck on, but fantastic grounds around. We still had.
And they do the Handel concerts in the grounds, probably.
Yes.
I think I've been to them.
Ah, right. Yes. Wasn't terribly good at music when I was there, but things there go up and down. But it was,
Co-educational school. Co-educational.
No. Girls only. I don't know that co-education would have been sort of thought of, and there were far fewer places then. But it was okay. I think the academic standard was very high. We had our headmistress at the time was Dame Kitty Anderson, who was a kind of major figure in. She'd been on things like the Robbins Report and so on. But she was a very nice, seemed to me an extraordinarily old lady at the time. But although she probably was, she did, because she retired when I was, I suppose, about halfway through. So she probably was quite old by then.
Were there any teachers who particularly inspired you or you liked?
Not much at the beginning, in the lower part. And I don't think I wasn't sort of terribly brilliant. The worst thing was maths. My maths was terrible. But I was obviously never, I think, well, I mean, well, I say never well taught, but I can blame them. But every time they made a new sort of lower maths division, I slipped down into it. And when it came to O levels, as they were then, they didn't put me in for maths because they said it wasn't worth the money.
Good heavens.
And this was not an impoverished school, you know, they just thought, not worth it. But the thing about North London was once you got into the sixth form, well, and even just around and about O levels, I think, there suddenly was an influx of young teachers. It just so happened, particularly for languages and art and English, and those were all things that I liked. And these teachers really were young. They were only, you know, 5-6 years older than us. And they all sort of came in a bunch. And in fact, they're still quite a tight crowd. They still meet quite often. And one of them lives around the corner from my mother, and I see her quite often, who used to teach me English. And so it was a complete sort of revelation. It was a turnaround. Somehow, suddenly, as you were getting into the lower six and the upper six and so on, you had these teachers who seemed, you know, almost like friends, and it just changed everything completely. One felt really kind of engaged with learning.
Was there any special one, or they were all, a number of them were like this?
I suppose I got on particularly well with Miss Finley, who taught Spanish, and Miss Harrison, who taught English, and also there was the wonderful Miss Threlfall, who was a potter. So those were, yes, one's particular favourites. And so different. I mean, they really were new and young. We'd had teachers before, teachers of history, who would just stand in the front of the class and read out notes, which you just had to copy down. You know, it was kind of... And then suddenly, with things like Spanish and so on, we were doing all sorts of things and writing plays in Spanish and having fun.
Around 15 or so, certainly in my school days, you were confirmed in the Church of England, and it was also a time of religious questioning and so on. Did this happen with you?
Not at all, no. I believe I was christened, but my parents were fairly militant atheists, especially my father. I mean, he had turned against the Catholic Church at about the age of 7, and was firmly against, and my mother, later in life, used to take to a slight sort of questioning and wondered about things like Unitarians and things like that, because I think she felt some belief in something, but my father was quite happy believing in nothing. And I never thought at all about religion. I did go, I used to go, much to my father's amusement. There was a nice boy over the road where we lived in East Finchley called James, who was my great friend. And when I was about 9 and 10, I used to go with him to his Plymouth Brethren Sunday school in what my father described as the tin tabernacle, because it was a corrugated iron shed just beside East Finchley tube station. But I was too good at answering the scripture questions, because I found all that quite interesting. Mm. I was kind of too good and too quick, and they didn't want me to go anymore. so, I mean, I know, me and religion has never really been...
Well, I was going to say, what about later on? Has it ever played an important part in your life?
Not at all. I did, when looking after Chinese Buddhist texts in the British Library, I was lucky that for a year I went to SOAS for a class which in reading Chinese Buddhist texts with a wonderful Japanese teacher and one other student who was also doing it, as it were, from the Japanese angle, but we would, you know, converge upon the text itself. And I enjoyed that fantastically. I found the sutras, you know, the subtlety of argument, absolutely fascinating, and toyed with the idea of becoming a Buddhist. I used to go with Jim to meditation classes in the Buddhist society, but I could never, I'm afraid, switch my mind off properly. And I remember also sitting in a temple in China on Jiuhuashan, along, this is much later, I mean sort of in the late 70s, listening to a long Buddhist service and sort of longing for the leap of faith, longing for something to happen, and it didn't. And in general, I fear that I think religion is responsible for some of the worst things that human beings do, you know. Mm. It shouldn't be, but it is. And that, you know, religious divisions are just ghastly. I can't understand religious fanaticism, but I, you know, one sees it, and it's a horrible problem. So I'm terribly against organized religion, really.
I mean, one of the things that my wife and I really like about China is the general absence of religion in Chinese life. I mean, there are lots of sub-religions, ancestor worship and Buddhism and Taoism and so on, but then none of them really religions, and they're all contending. So life is fairly practical and this worldly, with lots of ghosts and so on as well. But is that something you felt as well about China?
Oh yes, I agree. I mean, I think the Chinese are wonderfully pragmatic. You know, that the saying about being, you know, Confucian in office, Taoist in retirement, and Buddhist as death approaches. You know, you use whichever bits are the best at the time. But it does mean, yes, you're not tied into some organized religion which can make you do terrible things. You pick and choose. And I remember a friend of mine saying his grandmother was a Buddhist, and during the Cultural Revolution, when she couldn't have any Buddha figures or anything, she used to say her prayers in front of the portion of the windowsill where the Buddhas used to be. You know, that's sort of... I think their attitude is generally speaking, very good. And there are all sorts of wonderful practical things, like, you know, like ancestors, that ancestors are worshipped kind of quite, or seriously, for three generations. And then the tablets go into the ancestral temple. And that's to do with memory, to do with living memory. I mean, you don't remember five generations back, so what's the point? It's pragmatic. It makes you see that you don't need some kind of creed which tells you how to be good and how to be bad. You can pick from everywhere, and yet society works perfectly well. I think I agree with you about China. It's a refreshingly... Not, one wouldn't say anti-religious, but just not too religious place.
Mm. Do you think Confucianism contributed to that? Because it's a non-religious philosophical system on the whole.
Absolutely.
I mean, there is Tien, but, you know, let's forget about it in practice.
Yeah, and he's a great one. For, you know, you must go through the motions, but you don't actually have to be present, as it were. You know, ritual is frightfully important, but... Yes, I think, I mean, much as I dislike Confucius the person, as he seemed a sort of fussy old thing and so on, but I think that, yeah, he is supremely pragmatic and suggests how things should be without having to invoke the Almighty.
Hmm. What about another thing that sometimes becomes important at school time or that time, which is music? Has music been important for you?
Quite important. I think not as much as, say, drawing. I mean, I played the recorder a lot, and then I took up the oboe. Yes, at certain times in my life, music has been... I used to play in a wonderful orchestra, children's orchestra, from about 13 to 18, which was run by Kay Hurwitz, who was the wife of Emmanuel Hurwitz, who was the leader of the English Chamber Orchestra, in King Alfred's School, which was quite near where my parents moved to. And we used to go there every Saturday. And that was music making as pure pleasure. Kay was fantastic. There were lots of very talented musicians and not so talented. I mean, we had the Hurwitz's son playing cello, and he was terrific. Others of us, not so good. But everybody enjoyed it fantastically. I can remember doing Dido's Lament with him. Him brilliantly playing the cello and me doing the oboe. It was great. But I have to say, sadly, that Cambridge was completely different. And I gave up playing the oboe when I got here, because I went to see about the Newnham Orchestra, having had such fun. I mean, I think with Kay, what we did was really make music, you would say. We weren't aiming always to perform or anything, we were just doing it together. And I went to see about the Newnham Orchestra, which did, to me, sound a bit like, 27 cats imprisoned in a sack. It didn't sound good, but they were frightfully sniffy and said, oh, you have to have an audition and we might not take you and things. And I just thought, where is the fun? There's no fun in that. So I gave up. But I mean, still, music remains important to listen to.
I was going to say, what particularly? I mean, classical music or?
Classical music, I suppose, basically, yes. Plus, I have memories of things like my parents. Well, my father especially was crazy about Georges Brassens, and that's a sort of childhood sound of my father typing away downstairs and Georges Brassens. So people like that. Never hugely brilliant on pop music. I mean, I like Bob Dylan and things, but classical music would be the kind of main theme.
Do you listen to music when you're writing, or?
I do, yes. I listen to music, or sometimes have music, the radio as a whole. I liked having something. Music sometimes can be a bit annoying because you have to keep getting up and changing it. But
you like to have a sound going on.
Yes.
Interesting. People divide very strongly on that.
Simon
Schaffer can't work without a heavy amount of music, and other people can't abide it.
If there's a loss, yeah.
Interesting. Finally, on the school side, any particular hobbies? Anything that you outside? I mean, sport. We haven't. I guess you weren't.
I don't think there's much point looking at me in sport. I've never been any good at any of it. I always remember, we just laughed, but I mean, netball. We had a teacher called Miss Lewis. She used to go run up and down the netball court saying, throw up, throw up. And we used to think that was about right, And remember there was a swimming pool at school, which was open air when I was, of course, now it's been heated for these young people these days can't take the 60 degree temperatures we had to go. And I just remember sitting on the edge of it with Miss Lewis's knees in my back, sort of edging me in. I did win prizes for breaststroke style. So I can swim elegantly, but not fast. I mean, but that's, sport never kind of much interested me. And actually, one of the things that was quite good about North London Collegiate was that they weren't very, I mean, they did encourage you to move about, but it was fantastically uncompetitive. I think Frances Mary Buss had decided that in general, girls' education should be like boys, but the one thing that was wrong with boys' school was there was all this kind of inter-house competition on sport. And so we didn't have houses and we didn't have that kind of competition, which was a great relief. So that was, not much sport for me at all. I mean, I still enjoy swimming, but I've never been competitive, and it does help with sport to be very competitive.
Let's go on to why did you come to Cambridge?
well, it's I had a slightly complicated life. In school, I did my A levels were English, French, Spanish, and art, and I considered, on the basis of French and Spanish, that I was a terribly good linguist. You know, I've since discovered that I'm completely incapable of learning German and Japanese. Any language that's got an awful lot of grammar that you've got to kind of be rigorous about, I'm hopeless at. But I was quite good at those. I mean, French was easy for me because we'd gone to France every year since I was two, because of my father and my mother's interest. Anyway, so I thought I would do a language, and I decided I wanted to do a language that was as different and as difficult as possible. Which, given my relative laziness, was a bit of a silly thing to do. But I chose Chinese completely out of a hat. We were forced, rather, into decisions. You know, if you're going to do this at A-level, you have to know what you're going to do, and so on. So I just always said Chinese.
At A-level?
No, I didn't do it at A-level, but it was with the aim of doing languages at A-level, because, and after that, what are you going to do? I'm going to do Chinese. Mm. And I didn't choose Arabic, for which I'm eternally grateful, because I think, you know, being in all Arab countries, of any Arab-speaking countries, would be tragic, and also very difficult if you're female. I didn't choose Japanese because also Japan in the 60s was still very anti-women, really, very difficult. So I chose Chinese completely out of a hat, and I'm terribly glad. And when it came to universities, I had actually in the interim gone to Liverpool Art School for a year, but I hated it at first, so I studied for Cambridge entrance kind of on my own in Liverpool, and went back to school to take the exam. And the only places to do Chinese then really were Oxford, Cambridge, London and Leeds. And I went to interviews in all of them except Oxford. Oxford at the time had only about two people teaching Chinese, which obviously two people doesn't make a faculty. I mean, there wasn't enough. Leeds was kind of building itself at the time. I remember going to see the Oriental faculty, and it was like one of those nail houses in China. Mm. It was a little Victorian house in a sea of mud and bulldozers, because the university was being built. And I thought, I didn't really fancy that. And London, the professor was just about to come here, Professor Twitchett.
Yes, mm-hmm.
And Cambridge was definitely the best place of all at the time. And Oxford is bigger now.
Michael Lowy and...
Michael Lowy, Pete van der Loon, and Dennis Twitchett just transferring at the same... And he came as I came. So it was fantastically good. You know, David McMullen as well. So it was the best place, certainly. So I'm glad I chose it.
And then it had Wade Gills or Giles or whatever, the librarians earlier. And Needham and so on and so on.
Well, yes. I mean, I think Needham is an important point, because I didn't realise before I came, really, about how important he was, but he gave us a couple of lectures, and it was just fascinating, so that was a kind of extra thing. I think, and it was great fun to study then, because you had the sort of, Professor Twitchett was absolutely brilliant, and a fascinating lecturer, but he obviously didn't much like lecturing, and he had all sorts of wonderful problems of, you know, he couldn't come and lecture because his car had fallen down a hole. He couldn't do, and one point he was suffering from St. Anthony's fire. You know, we were always agog to know what on earth it was. And he would then do sort of a whole term's lecture in a morning. But they were fantastic lectures, so it didn't really matter. And then afterwards you had the wonderful difference between Pete van der Loon and Michael Lowy, that they were so utterly different in their approach to language, and you had to remember who you were preparing a text for, because they had their idiosyncrasies, and they could always, Pete van der Loon would come down on you like a ton of bricks if you used a Lowy-ism, for example.
We're interviewing Michael Lowy and David McMullen and others. Mm. We've done Michael Lowy about 4 hours so far. Tell me about him as a teacher and colleague.
It's quite difficult in a way, because my attitude to him has changed over the years. At the time when I came, this is 1967, I came up. And, you know, we go through 67, 68, and one is not unaware of turmoil throughout the universities and... you know, and what's going on in Prague and this kind of thing. And Michael Lowe was very, very conservative. I mean, he was rather a sort of slightly opposed with him, but and he used to moan that, that young people these days didn't read enough Greek. And and I remember having tutorials with him in the building when they were just they just finished the history faculty building, the James Stirling, you know. And I always used, he always used to say every week, "Oh God, it's so hideous, that building, I can't bear it." And I say, "Oh, I think it's really nice, sir." You know, generally speaking, we didn't kind of really agree on anything very much. But one survived. And I remember he also, he'd been at Bletchley. And even my mother found him a bit baffling, because I think she found Bletchley, well, it was wartime. She didn't really enjoy it. But he said to me, "Say to your mother, Bletchley Station." And it was obviously to him, it was a memory, a treasured memory. So I went home sometime and said to my mother, "Bletchley Station." She looked completely blank. She couldn't understand at all what the romance was. Anyway, so he was very conservative and made it sort of clear. But the thing is that since then, I don't know, I mean, I have huge admiration for him now, because I did quite a bit of work on the first emperor of China, and I used all the sort of things that he'd published. And so we have, you know, we've grown closer together, I think.
And David McMullen?
Well, he was, yes, he taught us mainly history, and he was, well, he was very young and very shy.
Still is shy.
Yes. Even though he's retired, yes. So, and he seemed really rather terrified of us. And I suppose in a way, you know, it was a more difficult time, because 67, 68, there were the, you know, the garden house riots, and there were occupations of Senate House, and even though we weren't particularly involved, because doing Chinese you had to work so hard, you had to, you know, you had, it was more like being at school, that you had to go in every day and learn the language and so on, so you had less time for demonstrations. But even so, I mean, David seemed particularly terrified of the students.
You mentioned that you were taught by Martin Bernal, who was a distant cousin as well. He would offset Michael Lowe to a certain extent, wouldn't he?
Yes. And I don't think, well, actually, I think in his autobiography, which, you know, he just published just round about the time he died, he particularly felt that Twitchett, Dennis Twitchett, didn't like him. I mean, Martin was very left-wing. Well, and couldn't really help it. I mean, I don't know. He was left-wing himself, and then, of course, but I mean, in a sense, I think tainted a bit to people by his father, who was a very nice old man, as I remembered him, but was considered, you know, a hopeless red and fellow traveller. Now, Martin taught us, I mean, an absolutely fascinating sort of late Qing text about the Boxers, which was really interesting. And, yeah, he was really good fun. His lectures were great. And one began to understand bits about sort of 20th century history. I remember writing essays about the May the 4th movement. I mean, really important things, which somehow you felt the other people were a bit bogged down in the past. And Martin was the only person who was interested in the 20th century. And the great, the wonderful argument, you know, which nobody has yet resolved and which one can think about, you know, why did the communists win? How on earth did a peasant army sweep aside, you know, Russian and American supported Kuomintang, you know, so with him it was really interesting.
Were there any other teachers who influenced you, or you went to their lectures or got to know?
I did go to we were terribly busy, basically. It wasn't that easy to go to other places, but I did go to history of art lectures, but I was absolutely appalled by those.
Michael Jaffe, or
yes, Michael Jaffe. But they just tended to sort of put up a picture and say, "Wow, it's really beautiful," and go on to the next one. And that wasn't good enough for me, so I gave up on those. And no, otherwise, well, I mean, as I say, we had Needham give us odd lectures, and also at one point we had a stunning time, because David Hawkes came over from Oxford to give us lectures on The Dream of the Red Chamber, because he was in the middle of translating it. And that was absolutely riveting. He's the most he was, sadly. He was the most wonderful lecturer. I always remember something, I think it was at a different session, but him saying with China what was difficult was to disentangle the whether it was a question of the historicization of myth or the mythicization of history, which is just absolutely fantastic when you think of people like Guan Yu, you know, who is a real person who becomes a god, and that, you know, the whole of the romance of the Three Kingdoms is kind of, you know, godlike and human. He was absolutely brilliant. But then I think he used to come over in a little sort of rather sporty car, but unfortunately he crashed somewhere between the two, I think, and it was the car that suffered. So that was the end of our stunning lectures.
That's sad. What else were you doing as an undergraduate? I mean, you sound as if you just worked, but did you do anything else, any politics or drama? Or I imagine you didn't row, but...
I cooked, particularly when this new Strachey building was built. That was my second year in Newnham, and there were kitchens. I tended to cook for friends mostly. I had very good friends, many of whom were architects, and so I was quite involved with them, helping them make models and things like that. But it was mainly, yes, it was cooking. And I had discovered one of my parents' neighbours as Claudia Roden, who kind of brought Middle Eastern cooking to the world. She lived two doors down, and I used to earn money in the summer holidays babysitting her children whilst she was writing Middle Eastern food. So I used to cook Middle Eastern food. I remember, you know, again, frightening poor David McMullen with a dinner of lamb meatballs with prunes, and I was also quite keen on dyeing the rice different colours. So, I mean, I suppose it was rather, you know, but it all seemed terribly avant-garde at the time. So cooking was one of a huge interest.
Did you do a thesis or dissertation as an undergraduate at that time or not, on a special subject?
You did, because, we did 4 years for Chinese, so, and in the fourth year, I took Chinese art and archaeology as my kind of special subject with Zheng Dekun. I suppose I should mention him. I mean, I don't know about influence me, but I liked him very much. He was an extraordinary, eccentric teacher, you know, who had been a major archaeologist in China and whose wife had a wonderful collection of little pots. She collected miniature pieces so that we could handle them, because it's much less dangerous to handle little pieces over a piece of cloth than it is to kind of handle great big things you might drop. I did a dissertation for him on the extremely fascinating subject of the kind of relationship of the Yangshao and the Longshan in terms of medieval, pre-Shang ceramics. It's the kind of very beginnings of Chinese civilization, so Neolithic. But I quite enjoyed it because I did lots of little drawings of pots, which was sort of part of my art school background. And I don't know if he was terribly impressed, but I enjoyed drawing my little sequences.
You obviously passed and got a... Did you get a first or...?
No, I got a 2-1. I certainly didn't work hard enough to get a first. In my year, there were a lot of firsts because there were a lot of very, very good people. Who went on, I mean, Tim Barrett, who went on to be a professor, Tim Wright, who went on to be a professor, Richard something or other, who went on to be a professor in New Zealand, etc. So, and I was definitely much more social than any of them.
Sticking to cookery.
Yes.
And then what did you do at the end of the undergraduate degree?
I didn't really know what to do, but sort of almost straight on, there were... straight away there were what I wanted to do was work in a museum with objects, but there were very quickly there was a job in the British Museum in the library on the information desk, and I applied for that and got that, and that was really good fun, actually. Nothing to do with Chinese, but it was a sort of inquire within upon everything. You had to learn about anything that a reader might or a person might phone in. There was a job at the Bodleian, which was specifically in the Chinese section of the library. So that was getting closer. But I went and I hated the new Bodleian building. It was so sort of gloomy, and it was just like the university library here, which is a horrible building too, deeply uninspiring. I didn't think I could face working in that building. And then a job came up at the School of Oriental Studies, which was in the Chinese section of the library. Again, not a museum, a library. But I got the job in SOAS, so I moved from the British Museum general post to the School of Oriental and African Studies library, Chinese library. And though I made many valiant attempts to get a job in a museum over the subsequent years, I never managed. So I stayed with books, first in SOAS Library and then in the British Library. And I think now you can, at least with antiquarian things, you can treat books as objects, so you can call a library a sort of museum.
Yes, well, they are museum objects now, sadly. But when did you go to SOAS? 70?
In 72.
Yes, I just left. You didn't come across my former supervisor, Christoph von Führer-Heimendorf.
Well, he was kind of around. I mean, I didn't much come across him because he was anthropology and I was Chinese. But
you knew of him.
But yes, a good name.
He was the deputy director at one point.
Yes, yeah.
And how long did you stay there?
I stayed there until 1977, with a year off in China.
Well, I was going to ask you about that, because you went to Beijing, didn't you, in 76 or?
75 to 76, yes.
Tell me about that. It's a very early time. It's just before the opening up, isn't it?
It was, one had a sense, you know, learning Chinese, it was a bit like learning Latin. I mean, you were so distant from China. Although I had had a chance with Tim Wright to go to China in 1971 for the first time on a so-called Young People's Tour, the first Young People's Tour since the Cultural Revolution began, which was organised by the Society for Anglo-Chinese Understanding. And I was able to do that because my maternal grandmother had died and left me a little bit of money. I think it was something like £250, which was enough to go on the Trans-Siberian to China for a month, because it was obviously very heavily subsidised. And I think Tim Wright and I scraped onto that tour by the skin of our teeth, because Saku really wanted to send young workers and young Maoists, and we weren't really considered Maoist enough. But somebody, Derek Bryan, I think, felt it was important to have language speakers. And it was a revelation, speaking Chinese in China. It was absolutely amazing and wonderful. So we come back, I start work. But one had that strong sense that we really didn't know how to speak.
What was that, 2 weeks or 3 weeks?
No, a month, like, actually. A month.
Like, I mean, this is two or three years after the Cultural Revolution.
And it was very...
Were there signs of it? Because this is the time that Needham goes and says everything is fine in China, if you remember. Was it fine? Did it seem fine to you?
Well, it was... We were definitely very much kind of... We were controlled, and we weren't. Yes, China seemed very fine as long as you were on message, as it were. You know, we were shown happy peasants. We went to all these extraordinary places... The Red Flag Canal, where, you know, the canal had been dug by young ladies swinging on ropes off cliffs and planting dynamite and kicking themselves away from, was very exciting. The Cultural Revolution in Shanghai was very boring. That was sitting in a room for days listening to a kind of blow-by-blow account. But there were odd things, like, for example, near the Red Flag Canal, one of the people on the tour was ill, some stomach thing, very, quite bad. And the group had to move on to Nanjing. And he couldn't really move, so I said I would stay behind and look after him because of knowing Chinese, and that happened. I mean, so he slept in the hotel and I wandered out in the village, and there was nobody looking after me then, and I spoke to all the villagers and had a great time. So, you know, sometimes you were very strictly controlled and sometimes you weren't. As I can't say how much did one learn. People were very, you know, there was lots of things about barefoot doctors, which were a very good thing, really, I think. And when we went to villages, for example, everyone would say, you know, who do you want to speak to? And everyone was rather kind of, I'm going to make my career by writing about barefoot doctors or writing about Communist Party leaders and so on, and there was nobody much left. I used to say I'd like to speak to the carpenter because I was interested in architecture, and it was quite funny because you'd have village carpenters who were a bit sort of dumbstruck because they'd never ever been asked to speak to foreigners before, whereas, you know, the barefoot doctors were super fluent and so on. And we would have nice times with them showing me their tools and, you know, how they run. They had these lovely ways of lines with a little inkwell. You pull your rope out through and it's covered in ink and you flick it against the board, and the saws and so on. And so, so yes, China was all right in a way, but of course we didn't know about people being locked up.
Didn't really know about either the Great Leap Forward or the Cultural Revolution.
No.
Yeah.
But and when I went back, as it were, when you come to 75, I mean, I had decided I must learn to speak better, as it were. And the British Council had been running scholarship groups to China since 73. So we were the third batch to go for a year with British Council support. And I just decided one had to go, you know, you had to go and spend a lot of time there because otherwise you'd never really learn to speak properly. And it was jolly interesting and, generally speaking, enjoyable. I mean, one became much more aware of the iron hand and the velvet glove. As if you're there for a year, you can't kind of help missing things. But, I mean, you then end up with very much babies in bathwater, I think. You know, there were certain things about the Cultural Revolution that were good. I mean, this extraordinary equality.
For women, particularly.
Yes, and for people, that, you know, nobody had more bicycles than anybody else, and nobody had more this than anybody. It was this kind of, you know, and a sufficiency and so on. But you did begin to sense that people were getting a bit bored by control, and that political movements were coming too thick and fast, and people, they were just going above people. You used to watch people going to sit at mass meetings, taking their knitting with them, that things needed to change.
Were people coming back from the countryside by then?
No, not really, no.
And education starting again or anything?
No, it all happened the year after I left. I mean, it's kind of, you know, the year that I had there was very much, you could sense that things needed to change a bit, but they weren't going to, and it wasn't until Mao died, and that was sort of 3 weeks after I'd left. And then all of a sudden, total reversal, you know, which was pretty extraordinary, because some of my fellow students were able to stay on for another year, and, you know, the second year was just completely different from the first. I had to sort of go back, really, because I was working.
But it reinforced your enthusiasm for China, and you wanted to continue.
Absolutely. I mean, I've always, always found China and Chinese just endlessly fascinating. I just think it's such an extraordinary culture, and it's so different, and everything you learn, it's terribly interesting. I think it's a, you know, I mean, things like the way things are put, you know, the way that colours are divided slightly different, things like, you know, that the word for an owl is a cat-headed eagle, which if you think is just such an incredibly good description, that the word for a cat purring is saying the cat is reading the sutras. They're just, you know, I just find the Chinese way of putting things endlessly interesting. And Chinese history and Chinese culture, just boundless. There's always something to learn, which is great.
And Chinese people?
Yes, Chinese people. I think I have some very good friends, you know, who I've had for sort of 30 years, particularly scholars who'd worked on the British Library collections, and those, you know, those really long friendships are very, very important.
They make real friendships, I've discovered.
Yes, and what's nice is that it's now, you know, it's now possible. I mean, when I was there as a student, I shared a room with a very nice girl, but it was impossible really to keep in touch at that time because it would have been too dangerous for her. But now things are very different, so, and sort of, you know, once you are known and they know what you know and why you know and so on. I mean, I think it's, with people in China, trust is important, and trust takes time to develop, which is as it should be.
You know, after that Yeah. Back to the same job.
Back to the same job for a while, and then about a year later, I moved from School of Oriental African Studies to the British Library, to the Chinese section there. At first for a temporary job, but that finally became permanent. And that was to do with, always wanting to stay with Chinese. That's frightfully important. But in SOAS, a lot of the work that I did was more with sort of everyday sort of books. And I did want to get, closer, as it were, to the book as object and the more antiquarian collections in the British Library.
Mm. How good are they, the collections?
Ah, well, the British Library has, you know, by chance got part of the world's earliest paper archive, the documents from Dunhuang that were found by Oral Stein in 1909, which include...
It's got part of the Dunhuang collection.
Yes, I suppose we've got about a third. Mm. But, I mean, that's 25,000 sort of items. I mean, it's massive, absolutely massive. And it includes the world's earliest securely dated printed book, the Diamond Sutra in Chinese, dated 868. So it's a really stunning and fascinating collection. All that paper, I mean, Chinese paper is so beautiful. It's musical, it's beautiful to look at, it's lovely to handle and so on. And you know, with that mass of material too, really kind of still largely untapped. There are so many ways in which scholars want to look at it. And so it's sort of, not only is it a fantastic collection, which happens to be in London, but also it attracts enormous numbers of Chinese scholars. So it made the British Library a very lively place for Chinese studies.
The other two-thirds are in Paris and...
Paris and Peking. And there's a bit in St. Petersburg, but they're sort of big main collections. And the Paris collection was collected the year after Paul Pelliot dallied on the Northern Silk Road, and Oral Stein swept in and snuck away with the first bulk of the collection. Then Pelliot took a similar amount to Paris. And then finally the authorities in China realised, well, they knew, but they realised that they should rescue this, the remaining manuscripts from the cave. And so they sent a series of carts to take away the rest.
Were you chair of the committee, or were you certainly involved in the supervisory committee for the Dunhuang project?
Well, yes. I mean, the Dunhuang project grew out of the work that that started really sort of as I came to the British Library. In 1976, when I was still at Peking University, I suddenly got a phone call saying, your father's boss is here, which was kind of completely baffling to me. But the head of the British Library had come to China with a small delegation, and he was made aware of the importance of the Dunhuang collection. And when he came back to England, he authorised the rehousing of the whole collection. Special cabinets were made. I spent my first summer putting all the manuscripts, 7,000 manuscripts, into these new cabinets. And generally beginning the rehousing, we were then aware of the fragments in the collection. So 7,000 fairly complete scrolls, another 7,000 items which were scrunched up and needed really careful conservation before they could be opened up. So I suppose I spent the next 20 years getting money together to get this material conserved, and then it was being studied by a team of Chinese scholars who came over. We had to get the money to support them, and, you know, because in those days China was very poor, scholars didn't have access to money, so it was a long fundraising business, looking after the scholars and finding their accommodation, looking after them, but making the Dunhuang material accessible. And finally, you know, as technology developed, it was about 20 years ago decided that it really should be put up on the web so that it's much more easily available. I'd always been working towards printed facsimiles, which the Chinese still want, but obviously the web is another thing that needs to be exploited, and so Susan Whitfield started doing that. I mean, she had been working cataloguing the material, but eventually she was very keen to put it up on the web. So yes, it's all been part of a long development. Sort of in a sense my whole career in the British Library has been to do with Dunhuang and making the material accessible.
Have you been there often? Have you visited often?
Not terribly often, no. But in a sense, I mean, there's a contradiction in China between Dunhuang itself and the place where almost all the Dunhuang manuscripts in China are, which is Peking.
Mm.
You know, that there's the same thing. It's like London to the rest of England, that people in Dunhuang are a bit cheesed off that they're the great cache of manuscripts has gone to the National Library in Peking. So I went to, but I went to Dunhuang again, sort of just 2 years ago, as a tourist this time, not as an, I didn't want any special, in the footsteps of Joseph Needham, we went, we travelled up because Needham had been there. And that was absolutely fascinating. And Dunhuang is a lovely place because it hasn't changed too much. I mean, I find much of China now has changed so much and has, you know, is so full of skyscrapers and, you know, one mustn't stand in the way of progress, but it can be a bit sort of distressing.
Mm.
But Dunhuang, out there in the Gobi Desert, still surrounded by these wonderful sand dunes, low rise, no tall buildings, it's lovely, it's a relaxed little place, which is great.
So you're thinking of going there this year, maybe?
I recommend it hugely. It really is very, very nice. And the whole Gansu corridor is fascinating.
Mm. We'd go up that. We'd probably follow Needham's route.
Yes, yes.
From Chongqing or Chengdu. This is perhaps an impossible question. I don't know if it's ridiculous, but if you had to sort of summarise how the discoveries have changed our view of either Chinese history or Central Asian history, very simply for a wider audience, what would you say?
I think if people understand about the cache of documents from Dunhuang, they realise that we know from it we can learn about not just about Chinese Buddhism, we learn about paper, the use of paper, the varied uses of paper, the significance of paper in Chinese civilization and indeed in the civilization of the world. I mean, the earliest document from Dunhuang is dated 406 AD. Now that's just under 1,000 years before paper actually gets to Europe and is used in any way. So you've got paper, so you've got technology, the economy of China in the sort of 6th to 9th centuries, because there are fragments of censuses, of tax returns, understand the life of ordinary people, contracts of sale and barter and so on. There are fragments of legal system. I mean, actually, from the Dunhuang cache, these manuscripts which date from about 400 AD to about 1000 AD, you get a complete spread of, as it were, Chinese culture of the period. So there are Confucian texts, there are dictionaries, there are Taoist texts, mostly Buddhist, but there are all sorts of things. We can learn about everything. And also, I think what is important about Dunhuang is that it has also brought the Silk Road really into prominence, that it's one of the most significant places on the Silk Road. It stands just where the two roads divide, the northern and the southern routes going round the kind of Central Asian desert. And people understand far more about the trade and life in that area from what's been found there. Mm. It's truly significant.
Just mentioning the Silk Road, have you read this recent book on the Silk Road by Prince whatever at Oxford? I'm trying to think of his.
I know what you mean. No, I feel rather guilty that I haven't yet read that, and I ought to, because I'm quite conscious that it's much more about the bits of the Silk Road I don't know so much about.
It's more about the Western area.
That's exactly. I mean, I always approach the Silk Road from Chang'an up to Dunhuang, and then to sort of the edge of China, and beyond that I don't know so much, so I ought to.
It's very, very good, very well written, interesting. Well, this perhaps leads on to your own work. If you had to single out what you thought was most interesting in what you've written, because you've not only catalogued things, but you've written books on Marco Polo and so on, What would you select as your desert island selection of your work?
I mean, mostly what I've tried to do is introduce aspects of Chinese history to an intelligent but not not involved audience, if you like. But I mean, I suppose the book that I'm happiest about really is the one describing my experiences in Peking as a student, the hand grenade practice in Peking, which has just been reprinted yet again. I suppose because it's personal. It reminds me of a very sort of happy, if occasionally slightly difficult time. And I also find it, I think it is quite funny because, you know, people don't realise what the Cultural Revolution was. And we were there in the last year of the Cultural Revolution. So everything we did was, as it were, Cultural Revolution. And as I say, 3 weeks after I came home to the shock horror of the West, as it were, again, the whole thing was reversed. But we shouldn't forget the Cultural Revolution because I think it had a very important role to play in many people's lives. I mean, you only have to think of, you know, the current government, for example. I mean, they were all young during the Cultural Revolution. They knew what that was. Does it form them, you know, in a way that is antagonistic to Cultural Revolution views, or are they pro? It's a very significant period, but it's a period difficult for foreigners to understand, I think, if you weren't there. If you didn't see it, it is difficult to imagine.
How much did it destroy in terms of Chinese culture and civilization? Because there's roughly two views. One is that China has had this kind of thing a number of times, been mown down by great revolutions and changes, and yet it revives and comes back more or less as the China that was there before. The other view is that this was such an extreme form of destruction that much has been lost and it won't come back.
I don't tend to the latter view. I think it's quite extraordinary how much didn't get destroyed. I mean, buildings largely weren't destroyed, museums were locked up, you know, things were shut away. So that when Red Guards went on the rampage, what did they destroy? It's interesting, they destroyed people's personal belongings. So you can say not the contents of the national museums, but things like photographs. And I find it funny now that often Chinese people get quite cross about, you know, albums of photographs of China being sold at Sotheby's or something, and they say, well, they should be in China. And you have to point out that actually, you know, foreigners preserved their photographs of China better than the Chinese did. So a lot of what one might call ephemera, but which is of course of deep social significance, was destroyed. But I mean, as for sort of culture as a whole, I think it's bounced back a lot. I mean, it bounces back to some extent with the help of Taiwan, where continuity has been stronger. But we also have to remember that Taiwan is very much a southern state, and so that things come back into China with a very strong southern flavour. Now, I think, you know, physically, I would have said that the changes to China's cities that have happened since the Cultural Revolution, you know, the modernisation, the skyscraperisation of China, is much more damaging, at least to the sort of physical appearance of China as China. You know, so many of these cities, you don't know where you are, you could be anywhere in the world. They've lost a certain Chineseness, but you know, things like consciousness of language, I mean, you could say to some extent that the Cultural Revolution reinforces a sense of the past and of tradition, because people now, in terms of say texts and of studying ancient texts and so on, they're much keener than they were during the culture, than even before the Cultural Revolution. I think they gain a sense of urgency about their own civilization, because you could say, well, it might have been destroyed, but no, it's still here. We must do something with it.
That's my feeling too. If you would, this again is a difficult question, but if you were trying to explain to someone who knew nothing about China its essential nature, in other words, using a medical metaphor, its DNA or its deep structure if you're a linguist or whatever. In other words, three or four things you really need to know to understand China. What would you single out?
That it is a difficult question. I would, if you're trying to introduce it to someone who doesn't know, they might have a concept of civilization, and you have to say, it's a very different civilization. I think it does feel to us, to some extent, that it's a civilization that has grown up, you know, on the other side of the mountains. They are people, they're human beings, who feel like we do, whose emotions are the same, but in many other ways they're different. But these ways are fairly superficial. Their language is fascinatingly different. I think it, I would try and explain it as fascinatingly different. You know, it's amazing when you say to people, of course, well, there's no alphabet. People look completely blank. You know, they feel kind of, they feel at a loss without an alphabet. They can't understand how the language can develop and to such a, to an extraordinary sense of sophistication, but it's completely different. And you could say that in, I mean, one's in danger, I suppose, of sounding like, you know, Arthur Smith with his Chinese characteristics. You know, they are different because they shake hands with themselves and so on. But to some extent, you know, if one's not infantilizing too much, I mean, I think he's right in a way that they are people who do things differently, but they're still people and their emotions deep down are the same, but things look different. They appreciate things like writing above painting, which we don't, you know, calligraphy above painting and so on. So almost everything is looked at in a different way. And it is a way that is just fascinating. And also I think one of the things about the endurance of Chinese civilization, you know, that things endure much longer, that you can take a text written at the time of the first emperor and you can still read it now, whereas we have trouble with, you know, Chaucer, and anyway, you go a bit much further back, and we weren't even writing at all. So, it's old, it's long, it's different, and yet it's endlessly fascinating because of its difference.
I mean, I've often felt that some of the best books I've read on China are by Frenchmen, particularly Granet, Marcel Granet, and this is because China is. Basic premise is different from ours. Ours is individualistic and China's relational, structural in the French sense. Do you think that's a key to China, the difference?
Yes.
You can't be a single Chinaman.
And I think, whoops, oh dear, sorry, I've done up your tea. Is that going to be all right in your coffee? I think it's true about the French kind of having a better... That the individualism of the British does stand in too stark a contrast with feelings in China, with ideas in China, and that France is perhaps a little closer. I mean, the Chinese do have a strong sense of themselves as individuals, but it is subsumed within, and you have to fit within, and you don't stand out like a sore thumb, which is. To some extent, you know, English eccentricity and so on, that's, it's almost overprized here.
Tell me something about the first book of yours I read, which was the Marco Polo book, because my memory of it was that it annoyed me, because I thought when I went to China and asked people, Wang Mingming and so on, and they said, oh, well, you know, all the lots of things he writes in the book, someone must have seen them because they couldn't have guessed this. And then when I reread a bit of it and I looked at the description of it recently, you weren't arguing that it was all untrue. You were arguing that it was a set of separate texts and Marco Polo sort of gathered them together. Is that right?
Yes. It is. Yes, I don't want to kind of destroy, you know, I don't want to throw everything out at all. I suppose what I would say is that, yeah, I came to the conclusion that it's a sort of medieval database of what was known about China from different sources. And you can demonstrate that terribly clearly, that in the age of manuscript, if you're copying out a text for some rich patron who wants a book about the marvels of the East, and you find more stuff, you put it in. It's richer. It's got more in. It's a better text. You don't worry about whether what you're copying in actually comes from a sailor from Bordeaux in, you know, 1550, rather than Marco Polo in 13 or 1290, whatever. What happens is that the texts that people now use for Marco Polo are things like the Penguin or the Moule and Pelio edition, are actually patchworks of up to 50 different sources written over a period which is acknowledged by the compilers from possibly, well, from about 1300 up to 1550. So there's a huge discrepancy between, you know, in terms of time and so on. But what I feel is important is that the popularity, the continuing use of the text or the texts just show how much Europe was fascinated by China and that there was quite a lot of knowledge. I mean, so it's actually quite rich, but if you're using it to say this is what Chinese did in the Mongol period, you have to be very careful which manuscript you're using. You need to pay attention to the elasticity of the time. And I wanted people to be interested in the subject, really, because I just find it fascinating, you know. I mean, there are all sorts of things like, why is there no mention of chopsticks? Why isn't there this? Why isn't
tea,
there that?
Tea, I think you said.
Tea, exactly. I mean, it doesn't matter, really. It just, somehow it didn't get in. I mean, the tea bit, I wondered if, you know, was it actually, a lot of it was based on Persian accounts, because the Persians were drinking tea, so they wouldn't much necessarily say anything about it. To me, it's a kind of endlessly interesting subject to return to, but I don't want to sort of throw everything out at all. I did feel, you know, there are such interesting books about him too. You know, looking at Matthew Paris or people like that, it's a fascinating period.
And now, what are you?
What, and now, is it my conclusions about Marco Polo?
No, what are you working on?
What am I working on now? I've just finished one thing, which is, it's called 60 Best Chinese Books. I don't know. I would call them 60 Important Chinese Books, trying to introduce 60 major texts. Ones which have been translated either in part or in full into some European language, but, you know, going from the Analects of Confucius through to the 1980s. I mean, just introducing, so that people get a sort of sense of the spread of Chinese literature. I've tried to include technical manuals like the Tiangong Kaiwu and geographical texts and magical texts and Buddhist texts and so on. But so an introduction to Chinese literature, plus I'm just finishing, well, we're going through editing a book about China in the First World War. Because it's a subject that people know nothing about. They don't realise that China was an ally in the First World War and was treated appallingly. Yes, I mean, yeah. So I used to go to the public record office and come back absolutely hopping mad at the treatment of China. Anyway,
disgusting.
Yeah.
We went to Qingdao recently, so we saw all this. One more sort of theoretical question. I mean, I've wrestled with the so-called Needham question of, which many people say isn't a question, but anyway, that China, having been by the Song, you know, the leading technological and to a certain extent scientific civilization in the world, then with Needham's, if you look at Needham's graphs, you know, it levels off and they don't make the next breakthrough, according to Huff and people like this. And he never worked out why this was or solved this problem. I mean, people like Christopher Cullen say it isn't a problem at all. I mean, why should they? I wondered whether you had any thoughts on...
Well, yes, and it's what Mark Elvin, the high-level equilibrium trap, whatever,
that's right.
Which I always thought was quite interesting. I think I slightly agree to some extent. You think, well, why should they? I mean, you know, the thing is, China was going along fantastically well, and what it is the clash with the West, and it's only the West that says they're kind of really falling to bits, and because the West has spent a lot of time and effort developing amazing weapons and so on. You know, if the West didn't have weapons like that, China would have been fine, as it were. I think, you know, that what's all that treble cropping of rice and, you know, a sufficiency to feed people, do you need? My uncle, who was married to my aunt, who was an Indian scientist, he always claimed that one of the problems was to do, and I know nothing about this, was to do with mathematics, that they never developed a sort of mathematical basis that would enable them to do better engineering and things like that. You know, I have to bow to his superior knowledge in that area. But I think that partly fits in with Mark Eldin's idea that, you know, they reached a sufficient point where things were going fine, that they didn't need to go beyond. But, you know, what's the clash with the West is to do with economics, isn't it? And to do with greed, sorry. The Western greed for Chinese things and an insistence on getting what they wanted on their own terms. So I sort of don't see it. I mean, it does seem to me that sufficiency and self-sufficiency and not being too bothered about the outside world is a fine attitude to have, but it was only the West sort of pushing in that really forces change. And probably, you know, it does rather sort of cripple China, because I think the West, with its tremendous sense of its superiority, I mean, you have to have things like the McCartney Embassy, which I find quite an interesting moment. You know, the people on the McCartney Embassy were so convinced that they're, you know, the fact that they could bring a diving bell and a hot air balloon and a telescope to China demonstrated how much better they were than the Chinese. You know, just step aside, Chinese. We've got these things and we're better. It's arrogance, and it's the arrogance of the attitude does seem to me to sort of push the Chinese into corners that led them to sort of despair rather than positive reactions. I mean, there were people who were positive, but it does seem as if in the 19th century, you know, the only way forward can be through railways and technology and the West. And that shouldn't be the case, or shouldn't have been the case.
Well, I absolutely agree with you. There were some, like Hart, who were very sympathetic and understood and cared about the place, but many of them were extremely arrogant. And now that China is going to be number one, do you think they'll treat us as we treated them?
No, I don't. Because I think they are politer than we are in general. You could say that they have every reason to sort of, you know, repay or the scores of the past, and occasionally there is a kind of rhetoric about the sort of hurtfulness of the past, but I mean, which I hope they won't indulge in, because I think that is kind of quite backward as far. China needs to go forward with its own sort of confidence and not dwell on the past, and needs to sort of make its own decisions now. No, I can imagine they might be quite tough commercially, and so they jolly well should be.
Is there anything you would like me to ask you, Francis, that I haven't asked you about your family life or anything else? Sometimes people suddenly remember that they should have mentioned their children or something, or something. But if there's nothing, not to worry.
Not particularly, no. I think my only child came to China with me once when he was about 15. We went to Shanghai, and he absolutely loved it. But I think Shanghai was easier for him to love than other places. I'd taken him to Japan when he was about 9, and he didn't like that at all. But that was partly because as a small child, you're the centre of attention, and people want to pat you. But no, I don't think, I mean, poor Ed, as a child, he had Chinese au pairs, and he was quite good at sort of Chinese slogans and things like that. But he's not a sort of Sinophile at the moment. He's more interested in North Korea at the moment than China.
What a fascinating place that is too. Well, let's stop there, and thank you very much indeed, Frances.
Not at all. It's a good, grand point.